Hello, my name's Dudley Sally. I'm professor of economics at Georgia Highlands College, and consequently I'm professor of economics, but I'm from the faculty, and I'm here to help you. That's a variation of an old joke. I'm from the government and I'm here to help you. The idea, though, really is to give a vote of gratitude to the very fine math teachers that we have at Georgia Highlands. Our developmental math professors and our algebra and calculus professors do a very, very fine job. They do all the hard work, and then we in economics get to have the fun with it. And so one of the things that I try to do in my coursework, in the microeconomics coursework, is to take that math background and tailor it into terms that will benefit them as they go on as transfer students to University of Georgia, Georgia State, Kennesaw State, and so on. And so what I'd like to do is share with you, we really have a joint mission here, and share with you some of the things that we do in the microeconomics course. Let's take a look at a brief PowerPoint intro that I use with my students. We approach graphs as the history of Western science, the idea of trying to use a historical approach rather than straight out of their high school algebra book. My background is liberal arts, so the idea is we would broaden the background of our students using the microecon course as the vehicle to do that. So business majors often avoid math and science courses. They just want to make money without having to solve those differential equations and things. But then they encounter Cartesian graphs in their economics courses, and they're not too happy with that, and the teacher relationship gets off sometimes to a little bad start. This is especially true in all microeconomics textbooks. The very first graph that is thrown at them is very devastating. This is the production possibility frontier. What it shows is that there's an inverse relationship that if you're producing civilian goods, this is a famous graph by Paul Samuelson in the late 1940s. We had World War II, so if you're going to produce guns for your war, you literally had to do with less butter, so everybody used margarine in the war. This is a terrible graph to start with, as math instructors are familiar. It is an inverse relationship, that is, there is a trade-off, and it's a polynomial, it's a curved line, and consequently, it incorporates the law of diminished returns. It's really half the class drops at that point if they have other options. So my approach is to introduce the idea of graphs historically. And it was Descartes, René Descartes, who developed graphs about the time French economists discovered the circular flow of income. So with a name like René, of course, he's a French philosopher and a mathematician. He's not an economist. But he developed his system of graphs about the same time that Quinet, who was the physician to Louis XIV, developed the circular flow diagram. So graphs are as much a part of economics as words like laissez-faire, entrepreneur, nouveau riche, and those many French words that enter economic discussions. So there's our circular flow chart. In the old days, everybody was on the farm and produced everything, and then they began to specialize. So farmers sold the wheat to the miller sold the wheat to the baker sold the bread to the farmer, and so we had the growth of the appearance of markets, a market system, and there needed to be some explanation for that. More than that, though, at about this same time, we're talking 1640, 1660, 1700, there was a break between metaphysics and physics. Now, philosophers deal in value systems of what is the good, what is the true, what is the beautiful. And so philosophers like Plato and most religious leaders see reality beyond the physical material world. These are concepts that are in beyond physics or metaphysics. Well, Descartes comes along and he says, well, that may be well and good, but we do have to take the physical material world seriously. So philosophers like Descartes and most Western scientists see reality as the physical material world that we can see and measure. There are many, many fights as to what is reality, even among the scientific community. Very, very famous fight between Einstein and Habermas and Wittgenstein as to what is reality. So drawing the line between physics and metaphysics, Descartes says we have to measure things. So we measure, say Western scientists measure observable material objects, giving them values. So these are physical material objects, such as a road. A road is a physical material object that we can measure, and we measure it and give it values, 1 mile, 2 miles, 3 miles, and so on. Another variable might be water. We can measure water. We measure it 1 gallon, 2 gallons, 3 gallons. Already there's a discussion in most science classes whether you're going to use milliliters or liters or gallons or what. So there's always a discussion in all science courses of what your measurements are going to be. We could also measure rain, and we measure rain. The values that we give to those are 1 inch, 2 inches, 3 inches, and so on. This corn, we measure corn by 1 bushel, 2 bushel, 3 bushel. So we have variables and we have values, and the reason we call them variables is they can take on various values. So we're learning vocabulary here. We have variables and we have values that we assign to those variables. And so you can, an example of drawing the line between metaphysics and physics, many of us believe in guardian angels, and so your homework assignment would be to measure the wrist circumference of your guardian angel. And of course, that's not possible, and consequently, that's not considered a scientific endeavor suitable for the lab. In statistics, it gets more complicated. We flip coins, so the coin is a random variable, we say, and the values it takes on, though, are just heads and tails, and similarly for many, many, much survey work. So let's go start our vocabulary list, why don't we? Over here on the whiteboard. And this is the vocabulary that I've tried to convert my students to use. So we have variables, and we have values. So values of the variables are the numbers that we assign to our measurements here. Now here's a picture of René Descartes, and I try to show students pictures of these particular individuals because it helps us date them. Descartes, it writes his very famous Discourse on Method that really invents the Western scientific method. He writes this in the 1640s. Remember, it was the 1620s when the pilgrims came to North America, and so he sort of looks like a pilgrim. He has a black coat on and a white collar. There's something different, though. He has long hair. He doesn't look like Miles Standish, so we call him sort of a hippie pilgrim, but that helps students remember that this is the era that we are dealing with. Let's go now to draw some of these things and follow through with Descartes. Descartes now says that there are two variables at a time. You can take two variables at a time, and such as rain and corn. Is there some connection between rain and corn? And yes, the values of the variables of rain. If we have more rain, then we have more corn. If we don't have rain, we don't have any corn. And if we don't have any corn, we die. So that's a physical material phenomenon that would be of considerable interest to most people. So Descartes says take two of those at a time, and it's good for students to get away from X and Y. Algebra teachers think there are only two variables in the world, X and Y, but really the world is full of variables. How much you run and how healthy your heart is, how much you eat, what your weight is, how fast you drive, and how many tickets you get from the highway patrol and that sort of thing. So let's take two at a time. The victory over Cartesian analytical geometry is you take two of these at a time, and you can draw a picture of those. Let's step over to the overhead and draw some of those pictures. So we have a relationship we're looking at. We have a relationship that we're looking at between corn and rain. And this is a relationship, we would say, a relationship or a correlation. In statistics, we say there is a correlation between rain and corn. Now, the math professor would say this is a functional relationship. That is, corn is a function of rain. Simply, if we have rain, we're going to have corn. But it becomes very mysterious because the math teacher usually says Y is a function of X. And that confused me as a student, but I'm a good Southern boy, and so when she said Y is a function of X, I said, that's fine. If that's what you say it is, that's what it is. If she had only said that corn is a function of rain, then I would have found out a little bit more about what she was talking about. Descartes goes on, he says, we can draw a picture of this. We can place on a ruler down here, and the ruler reads from left to right. We have 0 on the left-hand side, and the numbers get bigger as we move to the right. And we can put down there on the horizontal axis, we call that the horizontal axis, that is corn. And on the vertical axis, we can put our rain. And there is a relationship between the two. If we get an inch of rain, we get 2 bushels of corn. If we get 2 bushels of rain, 2 inches of rain, we get 4 bushels of corn, and so on. So we can draw a line of this relationship, and we call that one a direct relationship. As one value gets bigger, the other value gets bigger, and as one value gets smaller, the other value gets smaller. So we move up and down the line. That's a much easier graph for students to get used to. We also have inverse relationships. We can say that we have corn on the horizontal axis. Remember, that's the horizontal axis. We don't say that's the corn axis from now on. Teachers tend to say that's the x-axis, the horizontal axis. We could also have bugs up here, and there's a correlation there. But this one says that if we have lots of bugs, we have very little corn. If we have fewer bugs, we have more corn, and so on. And so we have here an inverse relationship. So there are 2 kinds of relationships, a direct relationship and an inverse relationship. And that's it. Those are the only 2 kinds of relationships or correlations between the values of the variables. So we're looking at correlations between the values of the variables. So let's add that to our vocabulary list. So we're looking at correlations. Correlations between the values of the variables. Correlations between the values of the variables, and we can draw a picture of that. Now, when we draw a picture of this correlation between the values of the variables. Let's take a look back at our direct relationship. There are many other things that affect the price or the quantity of corn that we're going to grow. There's the amount of sunlight. There's the number of workers out there, whether we have a tractor or not. Whether we have fertilizer. And those things are also variables that affect the amount of corn that we get, but they must remain constant while we're checking out just the individual value of rain. That's the big difference between the Eastern approach to science and the Western approach to science. Easterners try to get all these things into the harmonic conversion or something. But Descartes, remember, the secret of success with Cartesian graphs is to take only 2 at a time. So we take only rain and corn, and the rest of these have to sit still. And when variables have values that sit still, we call them constants, a constant, or the grown-up word is parameter. So every time we draw a line on a graph, hundreds and hundreds of variables must remain constant. And we call those parameters. And the parameters keep us fixed on the line. The parameters hold us onto that line, and they determine where that line goes on the graph. And that's about as far as we get in high school algebra, because then it's only the teacher who can draw can change a parameter. Students can go up and down the line. They solve for x and y and can find the values of the variables, but only the teacher can change a parameter. So let's say that we change fertilizer. And if with 1 inch of rain we get 2 bushels of corn or something like that, if we add fertilizer, we're going to get more. With 2 inches of rain, we get 4 bushels of corn. With fertilizer, we're going to get more. And if you increase the parameter, the entire line will move to the right. And so whenever one of these constants changes, the entire line will move to the right. So we talk about parameter shifts. We talk about parameter shifts. Now let's apply this now to economics. Let's take a look at what we do in economics. I don't fool around with we do the production possibility frontier would be an inverse relationship, and then it's not as difficult to handle. Let's look at economics. People are interested in consumption, and so we look at demand, the quantity demanded. Put a little D there, the quantity demanded, let's say a pair of shoes, and that's going to be a function of the price of the shoes. It's going to be a function of the individual's income. It's going to also depend on, let's say, the activity of the individual, whether you buy one pair of shoes or two pair of shoes. It depends on the quality of the shoes and literally everything else that's going on. So in science, we use mu, looks like a U, but that's the Greek letter mu, for everything else that might determine whether our consumer is going to buy one pair of shoes or two pair of shoes. Now, in order to draw our graph, remember these all have to sit still. We call that ceteris paribus, other things remaining the same. Everything else has to sit still while you construct your graph with just two variables. So we do that. We draw our line here with, in this case, the quantity demanded on the horizontal axis. And on the vertical axis, we put price. And in general, as we look into the real world here, as we start with a high price and so many pairs of shoes are brought, if the price is lowered, we get a downward sloping curve. As the price is reduced on these shoes, people buy an additional quantity. And so we call that the demand curve. We call that the demand curve. And so as we move up and down the demand curve, here, the values of the variables change. At $35 a pair of shoes, maybe people buy one or two pairs. If they go on sale for $16 or $20, people will buy maybe four pairs of shoes. And so that's an inverse relationship. And it's movement along the line. And when the values of the variables move along the line, we quote what is written on the axis. So that is a change in quantity demanded. That is a change in quantity demanded as we change the values of the variables, movement along the curve. Now let's step in and do a scientific change here. Let's change income. Let's allow the individual to have a pay raise here. And if that individual at $35 a pair is buying one or two pairs of shoes, then that person would buy an additional three or four pairs, and so on. So what would happen if we increase income? The entire line is going to shift to the right. So every time that we have a change in a parameter that was constant as we moved along the entire line shifts. And once again, we have to actually read what is on the graph. In general, in high school algebra, this line is not labeled. But here, we do label it. That is the demand curve. And this is where we began. That would be our demand 1. And this would be demand 2, or some, in math often we say prime, demand prime, that has changed. So you have to distinguish between that. A movement along the line is going to be a change in quantity demanded, but a parameter shift of the line is demand. And you can read that on any Cartesian graph. So it's very important to distinguish between movement along the line and a parameter shift of the entire line as one of those constants changes. So we're off to a good start here. Let's look now at the full Cartesian system, where he builds up systems of equations and then tries to make predictions based on that. So let's go. We can do the whole thing. We've got our demand curve already drawn with our quantity demanded and our price. We know about the demand curve. And then we do a similar analysis and we come up with our supply curve. Now that's a direct relationship. And we combine the two onto one graph. And so we place that graph down here beneath the two, so people watching our presentation here see that this third graph comes from combining these two graphs. So now we have, you know, quantity demanded and quantity supplied, our price, and where the two lines cross, we label that an equilibrium point. And at that point, the quantity demanded will equal the quantity supplied. If it's not, if the price is too high, the quantity supplied will be too great, and the seller will lower the price, and so on. So we wind up here with what we call equilibrium values of the variables, that is PE and QE. And so those are the equilibrium values of the variables. New term, the equilibrium values of the variables. So we have variables, we have values of the variables, and we have very special equilibrium values of the variables, which in high school algebra, the teacher said is the solution to this system. Now we can perform an experiment. This is a scientific method, and so we're here at this point, at this price and this quantity. Suppose, though, that the entire economy does very well, everybody gets a pay raise, and consumers' income increases. What does that mean? It means now that the demand curve is going to shift to the right. So we have our demand curve, and we have our new demand curve. Well, our supply curve was up here. We have our new demand curve that shifts, and consequently, we have a new equilibrium, so we say E2. That gives us a new equilibrium price and a new equilibrium quantity. So what we're looking at is the change in the equilibrium price. So prices in the market go up, and the quantity exchanged in the market also increases. So this is the full Cartesian system. We want to know what happens before and after. So this is a scientific experiment. We are at E1, which is before, and some parameter shifts, and we are at E2, and that is after, and that's a scientific experiment. For instance, you may have a Lockheed down in Marietta. You may have an airplane in a wind tunnel. It's in equilibrium. You change a parameter. You tip the wing, and you see what happens. Does it crash, or does it stabilize back into its equilibrium? In chemistry lab, you have a beaker full of some solution. You disturb the equilibrium by turning on the Bunsen burner and see whether it explodes or whether it freezes or whether it turns into acid or something like that. In psychology, you have a mouse asleep over in the corner. You change the parameter, throw a piece of cheese against the wall, bonk, the mouse wakes up. You predict, is the mouse going to run after the cheese, or will the mouse yawn and go back to sleep? That's the nature of a scientific experiment. We call those, in engineering, I think they refer to those as an event, and they're very dispassionate about that. It's an observable event before and after, and this is the full Cartesian system. In economics, of course, we're using changes in market price and market quantity. Well, that's the sort of thing we do in economics. Let's move now, that's the full Cartesian system. Let's take a little closer look at how we can tie that in to our high school algebra. And we have some pretty bright kids, and we have those kids who have benefited from instruction in 0077 and 0099 in our developmental courses. Now remember, it's got to be sequenced. That's one thing I learned from working with fourth grade teachers, is that they're really good at sequencing. And so remember what we're doing here. We're learning how to draw a line on a graph, okay? Learning how to draw a line on a graph. That's more or less learning how to run. We stay on the line. Then we learn how to jump. We have a parameter shift that shifts the line. Then we put two lines on the graph. That's sort of putting the ball through the hoop, if you will, to get our equilibrium. And then we put the whole thing together. We're running, we are jumping, and we're putting the ball through the hoop. So you've got to go through each of these three sequences as you work. So let's do that. We start with a number of simple equations now. With the numbers. Beforehand now, we were not using numbers at all. We were just shifting. Our curves and learning the notation as we change the parameter. Let's do some numbers now. Let's look at something, let's say x plus 2y equals 20, and 2x plus 8y equals 56. So the students sort of say, well, we know all about that. I say it will help if you put your variables in parentheses. So we have our variables in parentheses. And this, some students forget that if there's nothing there, that's a 1. So our variables here are x and y. Begin to use that term. Students pretty well know variables. And these are the constants. The 20, the 2, and the 1 are constants. We call them parameters. They are variables whose values do not change. They're variables too, but the value does not change. Now we want to graph those equations. This is a system of two equations. Most students are familiar with that. And we want to graph the equation. They want to jump right in and solve it. We just want to draw, the Cartesian picture of that equation. Okay? So we'll put familiar on the horizontal axis, we'll put x, and on the vertical axis, we'll put y, and the 0 is down there for 0 or also for origin. Now in my day, we had to put various values in there, and you would plot those, and then you would connect the dots. Later on, we learned to use intercepts. Later on in my case in graduate school. I'm very pleased that is taught now, I believe, in the first several pages in the 077 or the 0099 course. It's really an easy way to do it. We deal with zeros. An intercept is if a line crosses the axis, that is a point of interception, just like a fighter P-38 or something intercepts the bomber. So that will happen when the value is zero. When the value of a variable is zero, it's the other variable in the equation is going to wind up right on the axis. So why don't we try that and see how it works. If our x value is zero, the y value will be 2y equals 20, or that is 10. And if our y value is zero, then x is 20. I don't have my scale too well done here, is 20. And you just connect the two lines, and we have our graph. Working with zeros is really very, very easy. Let's try the other one. If x is 0, 8 into 56 goes 7 times. And if our y is 0, 2x is 56, and so our value is, let me just extend that out there, our value is 27. So now we connect those two dots, and we have our graph plotted. We now have both of our equations plotted. Again, the students want to jump right in and solve that. I say, no, let's get our notation right. Where the two lines cross, we call that an equilibrium, E1. And the value that we could read off the graph if it were drawn to scale would be x1 and y1. Those would be the equilibrium values of the variables. So what we're doing here is plotting and learning how to do the notation. We're learning notation. So here's their first homework assignment. We'll put that on there. We give them a series of equations, and they go, it's homework, so they go home and they actually plot these. Now notice, back here, I'm a nice guy, everything was in the first quadrant. That's easy. Now though, we want them to spill into the other quadrant, so they do this as homework. They do a series of plots. They're anxious, of course, to solve it. We don't want to solve it yet for numbers. We just want to learn the notation. And so we plot the intercepts and the E, where the solution is going to be. Then they come to class, and we work on that. And so they come to class with all of those plotted. And what we do in class now is we change a parameter together as a class exercise. And we would change, for instance, this parameter 2, we would change that to a 4. And we replot that line. And they see very clearly then, when you change one of the constants or a parameter, the line shifts. The line shifts and you get a new equilibrium value. So we're looking for, it's an experiment, a scientific experiment. Experiment is the change in a parameter, and that gives us a change in the equilibrium values of the variables. And so that's a very good classroom exercise. I do that also online with my graduate students. Their work comes in looking something like this because they're very proficient. These are engineers. They have MBAs in mechanical engineering masters in mechanical engineering or something. They want to get their MBA, and so it can be done online, with great precision. It looks very nice. But in the classroom, we're very happy if we make the impression that when you move or change a parameter, the curve shifts and you get new equilibrium values of the variables. And so we then shift demand and supply curves all over the place without using numbers. And then we get really challenging. We move two lines at once. And so here again, this is the work of a graduate student, but we do that. Some of my undergraduates here at Georgia Highlands are certainly capable of doing this kind of work. And what we have here now is two parameter shifts. Here the demand curve moves to the right, the supply curve moves to the left, and we get new equilibrium values of the variables. Then we move the supply curve more to the right than the demand curve moves. Then in this case, we move the supply curve to the left. We have all these combinations of how they can move, but if you draw the graph and label the graph E1, E2, E1, E2, E1, E2, and the corresponding values, equilibrium values of the variables, you're all set. Now the numbers, okay? The challenge, the next challenge is how do we get the solution? Well, students are pretty good algebra students, and they've memorized that in order to get the solution, we use the substitution method, we use the elimination method, or if you were really good, you use Cramer's rule, and you get an x value and a y value. Well, let's show where that comes from. Nobody ever shows anybody where these rules come from. Let's see where the rules come from, and they come really by sleight of hand, but it's the next step that many algebra teachers take as you move into the calculus. So what you want to do is return to the functional notation. Functional notation being y is a function of x. Here we have this 2x2 system that's set up for solving the system. Let's do as we do in the next step in many algebra classes, I guess chapter 4 or chapter 5 or something. We want the y values on the left-hand side. So we say 2y equals 20 minus x, and we further get it down to y equals 2 and the 20 is 10 minus 1/2 x. And over here, 2x equals 56 minus 8 AY equals 56 minus 2 of X. There we go. And further isolating the Y value, Y then will equal 8 into 56 goes 7, and 8 into minus 2 is minus 1/2 X. Now, the algebra teachers go right from here to here, but that's how you do it. You isolate the value of Y and move it to that size. That's changing back to the functional notation. Now, that's a wonderful thing, because what you have here, notice what you've done. Notice what you've done by rewriting the equation in that format. You've automatically calculated the intercept. And you've automatically calculated the intercept. It's really great. Not only that, you have also calculated the slope of the line. The slope of the line, this was 1/4. The slope of your first equation is minus 1/2. It's an inverse relationship. And the other equation is minus 1/4. So you've automatically calculated the intercept and the slope when you do that. Not only do that, but it's the beginning of calculus. The first derivative of these is the slope. So if you did dy dx, you've got your answer. The first derivative is minus 2 dy dx. The first derivative is minus 1/4. So you've done quite a bit when you make that jump. But now you're prepared. Now you are prepared to see why this is a solution. We call that an equilibrium because things are equal. At this point, both equations will have the y value. Both equations will have the y value. So then y equals y at that equilibrium point. Well, what is y? Y, we've reduced here to 10 minus 1/2 x, and that will equal our other equation, 7 minus 1/4 x. And now it's just one unknown, so we can solve that. So minus 1/4 over here becomes plus, so it's minus 1/4 of x. This is minus 10, and 7 equals minus 3, and so x will equal 12. And so now we have the value here. Our x value is going to be 12. And we put the 12 back in up here, and we would get y equals 4, I believe. And so our y value here would be 4. And we have the equilibrium values of the variables. And how did we do that? Not by memorizing the substitution method or the elimination method. We made these two equal, and we call that the reduced form equation. The reduced form equation. That's what we talk about in higher math. We take both of the equations and put them into one equation, and that gives us our solution. So that is the reduced form equation. So we've got lots of vocabulary going on here. We have variables, we have values of the variables, we have equilibrium values of the variables, and then we shift a parameter and see the change in the equilibrium values of the variables by means of using the reduced form equation. And these are all terms that the students are going to encounter as they go into their advanced work. Maybe we should add to our vocabulary list over here. So we have variables, we have values of variables and correlations, we have parameters, and we have we have equilibrium values of the variables. And if we shift the parameter, we get new equilibrium values of the variables from E1 to E2, and that's a scientific experiment. That's what we call science. And so we're using economics as a vehicle to demonstrate what comes about in your chemistry and your physics courses. Let's continue now with the numbers. There's quite a bit going on here. Of course, we spread all this over an entire semester. So far, we just have two variables, our x and y, or our price and quantity. Let's take what we call a multivariate equation, a multivariate equation, while we're dealing with the numbers here. So what we would have then is that your quantity demanded of shoes or whatever we were looking at is a function now of not just price, but remember of your income and the advertising budget and the price of other goods. And so on with mu. Well, when we put parameters on that thing, it comes out sort of frightening. The quantity demanded would be something like 1,200. Your intercept minus 3p of x. That's the price of x here. plus maybe 5py, the price of a competing good, or I don't know, 3 times income plus 2.5 times your advertising budget or something like that. And in the real world, we actually encounter these multivariate equations. And there's lots of variables there, so you can't draw a picture of it, and so your staff sort of loses track of where you are. And if you will put in, we teach the students, if you will put in actual values for the variables here, it makes them constants, and as a result, what you've done is you've isolated this. You put those values, and this thing becomes, I don't know, 2,300 or something like that. And now, you can graph that where you have the quantity demanded is a function just of price, and you get your demand curve there. And that demand curve is very important for businesses to understand. And so the next step, of course, and we now need our statistics professors in there, is where do these coefficients or these parameter values come from? They come from the textbook, and all of your textbook problems, these are given to you. But in the real world, they are not. So we have to use regression analysis. We put in actual observed values from your own company into these equations. And we will estimate then the 3 and the 5 and the 3 and the 2.5 and so on. And these are parameter estimates, but they are frequency distributions. So now each of those has a normal distribution. You have to use the t-test and you have to use the z-test on that. So it all comes together, all of your algebra, all of your comparative static analysis, and on into your actual numbers. And that's, if you can do this, that's the difference. You know, you start as a graduate business student, maybe 65,000 or something like that. If you go back and get an MBA, or if you were really good your senior year in your program at Georgia State or Georgia Tech or someplace, they'll start you at 85 and you'll work your way very quickly up to 125. It's quite amazing if you know the numbers and know what you're doing with the numbers. Okay, take a deep breath. Now we're going to show the full Cartesian system, the derivation of that downward sloping demand curve from various propositions, general propositions. And this is the full Cartesian system, the derivation. And we work there with a series of graphs. We work with a series of graphs. No equations, not yet. Maybe later on in your junior, senior, you would actually use the equations here. And we can show you how you do that, really in your applied calculus course. That's really a wonderful connection that Georgia Highlands College has begun an applied calculus course, which is very valuable for our business students. So let's do the derivation of the demand curve. We do this in class. You have two equations. You have two equations, and that deals now with the quantity of one good B and the quantity of another good. Let's put B there and A down here. And what we want to do here is the consumer wants to maximize his utility. So we have a series of utility functions here. Total utility is 100. Total utility is 200. This utility is the benefit or the enjoyment that the consumer gets from eating an apple or two apples or three apples. And of course, the consumer wants to maximize that. And so he would have this much utility if there was that many oranges and that many apples, would have more utility and so on. The economic problem, though, is the budget limit. There is a budget limit. And that's another equation. We won't look at the equation quite yet. And that's a constraint. And this time, the consumer cannot go beyond that budget limit. Say the consumer, you know, has $75 to spend or something like that. So the idea is we want to get to the highest total utility curve within that budget. It's an optimization problem. It is an optimization problem. And so we want to maximize our utility, good business term, within budget. And so just like we did before, we place both graphs on the same curve. We place both graphs on the same curve. But now there is more than one point of intersection. Recall in our earlier graphs, equilibrium was simply where the two lines cross. So this is really coming of age now as these lines cross here and here and here. So which solution is the right solution? It's the optimal solution. It's the one that maximizes total utility. If we're at point A, we only get 100 units. If we're at point B, we get 200 units, and we don't have enough money to get out here. So you can be with this combination of apple and oranges or this combination, but this one would be preferable because you get the most for your money. That's the economic goal, is to get the most for your money. And we could do the same thing here. This is apples and oranges. We could also put capital and labor here, and these are trucks that you're producing, and so you want to produce the most trucks at least cost or something. And that's your equilibrium one. And it gets really interesting, remember, because we're going to change a parameter. So what we do is we reduce the price of commodity A here. This is commodity A, and we reduce that price. And what that does is it swings out this line. The line moves. And so we do that down on this other graph, and that's E2. And what we see is that quantity one, quantity two, that is price falls, the quantity demanded increases. And that's our law of demand. And so we want to show that as a demand curve. We just want to show this parameter as a variable. That's easy enough. We just drop down here. Here's our quantity of A still there. But now we want the price of A as a variable, price of A here. And so we started off at this point. The price one is here. The quantity is here. And so Q1 and P1 is there. The price falls to P2, and that was our new quantity. And so now we're here, and we got our downward sloping demand curve. And that is a full, legitimate Cartesian proof of why the demand curve slopes downward. It's quite remarkable. And you say, well, there's no way that our students can do that. That's not true. Here is an example of my students' work. This is the derivation, the same derivation. This is on a test. This is a closed book examination. The student is able to draw beautiful graphs and tell the whoever's reading his work, whoever's following his work, exactly what's going on. Beautiful, beautiful job here. Here's another one. Same class. These are sophomore level students at Georgia Highlands College. I would be very proud to show this at Duke University or Emory or any other. Our students can do really, really fine work. And again, I think I owe most of it to the math department. They are able to take care of us and get them started. If you're a student, you probably want to stop here. If you are, though, a member of our math department, let's show how we can jump up to the master's level and then to the PhD level and do the same thing. Let's do what we just did with equations. We have this series of indifference curves here, and what that is total utility is a function of the quantity of A and the quantity of B. That's a very generalized form of, you know, we have quantity of A and quantity of B here. Then our budget line is just a linear equation. Our money, which is a constant, is a function then of the price of A times the quantity of A, what we spend on A, plus the price of B times the quantity of B. And we want to reduce the equation. We want to put these two together, remember. We want to put these two together to get our optimum point. And so we need to get this equation expressed in terms of, let's say, the quantity of B. And so if we get P of A, Q of A over here, then that would equal M minus P of B, Q of B. We divide through by P of A, and we divide through by we want to express this as Q of B. I'm sorry. So we got P of B, Q of B here, and P of A, Q of A there. We divide through by P of A. Now we isolate Q of B, which is what we want to do. M minus P of A and Q of A. So what we've done is we've translated, this is really a substitution method, we've reduced this to that function there. So let's put that in there. The total utility is a function of Q of A, the quantity of A, and this thing here, which is our constant minus P of A, Q of A. Okay. And so we want to maximize that. The way we do that is we take the derivative of the total utility with respect to the quantity of A, and we get F prime Q of A, just the derivative of that. And this one's complicated because it's a function of a function. So this of course crashes out. It's the coefficient of the Q of B, which is minus P of A, Q of A, times the derivative of the function itself, which is F prime Q of B. And to maximize that, what we want to do now is we want to get the maximum value, is we set that equal to zero. You cross multiply and it comes out the quantity of A, F prime of A, over P of A equals F prime of B over the price of B. And that's a very famous proposition in economics, that the change in your utility as you consume additional units, the marginal utility of A over the price of A equals the marginal utility of B over the price of B. And that's something that I would hope there's an economic example that you can use in your applied calculus course. There's all kinds of opportunities to do that. Okay, now the big lesson, if you're still with us, that what we just did is probably advanced undergraduate calculus, differential calculus. Let's now jump to the PhD level, or maybe many of you are math teachers. We jump to the master's level if you are a math graduate student. What we want to do is the same thing that we were doing before, is that we have here a demand curve. We have a supply curve. We want to change a parameter. We want to change a parameter, move that demand curve over, and check the difference between E1 and E2, and see what the change in quantity is, equilibrium quantity, and the change in price. That's what we want to do. Well, how do we do that at the most? How do we do that at the most general level? Let's take the total differential. We have now. We have a quantity demanded, is a, keep it simple, is a function of price and income, and the quantity supplied is a function simply of price. Keep it fairly simple. So we have two equations here. We must have an equilibrium condition that the quantity demanded equals the quantity supplied. That's the reduced form equation that enables us to find these values of the variables, the equilibrium values of the variable, so we can then find out what the change in the equilibrium value of the variable is. So we take the total differential of these, that is the Q of D equals this equals the, you know, what is this? It's going to be the partial of, let's keep track of everything, let's put D there and S there so we can keep track. It's going to be the partial of this with respect to P, so let's say that's dP times dP, the change in P, plus the partial with respect to Y times dy. And we do the same thing here, the total differential dQ equals S with respect to P dP plus zero, because there's nothing there. Now it just becomes algebra. It's really kind of interesting. Let me, how we can keep track of this. Let's maybe switch to black. We can divide through by dy. Let's divide everything, divide by dy. And the same thing here, divide by dy. It's just algebra at this point, dy. And that's zero and that cancels out. So let's get these over to the left-hand side so we have a two-by-two system essentially. So now we have dq dy minus dp over dy. And that will equal dy, the partial. And here we have dq dy minus sp dp over dy, and that equals zero. Now remember I said way back in when we began, if you will put parentheses around your variables, that helps you out a lot. So what we've got here is our variable is dp dy and dp dy and dq dy dq dy. And what do we have here? This is dq dy as income changes, and this is dp dy. So we're solving directly for the change in the equilibrium value of the variables. That's, of course, one and one. We use Cramer's rule to do that, and it turns out the whole system depends upon these partials, the partial of d with respect to p and the partial of s with respect to p. Well, that's the slope of the line. That's the slope of the line. And the catch here is if both of these are positive, you get a system that looks like that, and there is no solution. Students think that every problem has a solution because there's answers in the answers book. If these are both negative, if they're both positive, you don't get a solution. So what has to happen? You got to set this thing up. You have to set this thing up so that you do have a solution. So it's imperative that the demand curve slope downward and that the supply curve slope upward so that you get an equilibrium solution. Well, how do you do that? The way you do that is you must have an optimization problem in order to achieve that. And that's why we do all of this. That's why we do all of this. You have to do this in order to make, you have to do this optimization problem in order to have your most general system have a solution. So that's what's going on in economics. It took me, I had to take the course a couple times, but I think that I finally figured that out. And that's where we're going if you're curious of, you know, what happens in mathematics in the economics course. And then in macro, we do the same thing where here, though, it gets to be more fun. Down here, we get GDP, which is whether we're having a recession or not, and up here would be the price level or something like that. We have an ag demand curve. We have an ag supply curve. And here we are, and it's 2010, and we want to know what's going to happen It's 2011. We want to know if the Fed Reserve or Mr. Obama is going to do things. And if they shift a parameter, we'll wind up here with prosperity in 2012. Although if they move this thing, we might wind up back in a recession in 2012. So it's just parameters. We talk in macro about, you know, policy parameters. Well, thank you for your patience if you've stuck with us this long. It's quite an interesting journey. I found it to be particularly interesting. After I took calculus a couple times and we applied it to economics, I finally began to see what the system was. It's very exciting. It can be maybe fun. I say the students have done a great deal of work in their algebra courses, and this would be the payoff, learning how to do comparative static analysis. And I hope we can work together in that review of algebra, learning the difference between variables and values of variables, equilibrium values of variables, and parameter shifts or shifts in the constants. We're all on the same team. I greatly appreciate the work that is done in 0077 and 0099 in the college algebra course, and certainly in the applied calculus course. It makes my job a lot easier, and I get the aha moment when the students can pull all this together. And of course, the best reward is when they go down to Georgia Tech and Georgia State, Kennesaw State, University of Georgia. They get A's in their advanced coursework, and it does not throw them. Let's do a very quick PowerPoint review to kind of see how all this fits together, and that way it's a speedy review of what we have done. So let's switch to that now. We started with Descartes. There's Saint René, and he started all this by his book, The Discourse on Method, in the 1640s. And he made the distinction of focusing on the physical material world. It's not that he didn't believe that values of the good, the beautiful, and the true, and spiritual values were not important. He says we also have to consider the physical material world as important. And also, that's where that concept of scientific positivism came from. We have to take the physical world seriously and positively, not in a negative sense. And so he starts by measuring. Western scientists measure observable material objects, giving them values. So we measure things like roads, giving them values 1 mile, 2 miles, 3 miles, water, rain, corn, and then statistics, of course, it changes a little bit. We still have variables, but the values change somewhat. And Descartes' scientific method says to pick two variables at once, rain and corn, eating and your weight, speed and traffic tickets, study and grades, that's the ones we like to say. Study more, your grades will be better, your hours work and your pay. And so we have a direct relationship that is a correlation between the values of two variables. And from there we can draw a picture of that. We put one variable on the horizontal axis, another variable on the vertical axis. If it's a positive relationship or direct relationship, we can compute the slopes if you want. I usually skip over that. Then we also have inverse relationships, bugs and corn. The more bugs, the less corn. The more running you do, the less weight, and so on. And there we get an inverse relationship, which would have a negative value on the... So then we have this relationship between corn and rain, corn and bugs. But remember, everything else has to remain the same. And we use this to show this opportunity, this horrible opportunity cost graph, which says if you go to the store, you only have so much money. You can buy more milk, but that means less orange juice. And so you get an inverse relationship on a Cartesian graph, which shows you've only got so much to spend. So if you buy more milk, you have to put the orange juice back. And so that's the way we work into that very difficult graph. All the time, though, other things must remain the same. Ceteris paribus, the correlation shown on a graph helps make predictions. More rain, the more corn, but only if other things do not change. This is the famous ceteris paribus, just like et cetera, other things cannot change. So we have corn and rain shown on the graph, so nothing else can change. Those are parameters. And so we have all kinds of parameters besides just the two shown on the graph. and the constants are the parameters of this analysis, or sometimes called assumptions. We're looking at the relationship between two variables. We have direct relationships that are positive, inverse relationships that are negative. Other things must remain the same, or the line shifts on the graph. And if the parameter does change, the graph will shift. So then we jump to market supply and demand. We get equilibrium values of the variables. We then shift the parameter, and the equilibrium values change. And that's what we're after. This is an experiment. As we have a market equilibrium, we change the income, and we get a new market equilibrium as demand increases. Increase in the parameter consumer income, market equilibrium price and quantity would increase. So here's our whole system here, the scientific method in economics. Pick two variables, price and quantity. Relationship, correlation between the two, as far as the consumer is concerned, the relationship between the two, the correlation as far as the salesperson or the producer is concerned, reach an equilibrium, then shift a parameter and predict that change. And so that's our use in that system, and we carry that on into many other systems. So basically, the idea was to review those basic ideas of variables and parameters, equilibrium values of the variables, and the shift in the equilibrium values of the variables as those parameters change. And that's what we do in economics. And again, thank you, those of you that work very hard with our students in the math department. They come to us really well prepared, and they're able to follow this pretty complicated routine. We, of course, don't go into the total differential and tell them the story behind the story, but I thought that you might be interested in that. So thank you for your attention. It's been a pleasure to work with you, and I hope this might encourage all of us in this work that we do at Georgia Highlands College. Thank you.